So we're going to start recording. Okay, we're going to talk about documentation a little bit. You have had a glimpse of documentation already with your medical dental history, but the maintenance of complete records for every aspect of care provided for each patient is really important for a dental hygiene practice, because the patient records, even though they can be kept at different formats, you can have handwritten records, electronic records, some are a blend of both. And different practices have different ways of doing things, but the essential factors for legal documentation of all aspects are all the same. And that means it has to be chronological. So you have to have everything dated. It has to be systematic, comprehensive, accurate, unaltered, and it needs to be signed by the dental hygienist. We need to know whose notes there are, that they're writing. So it's important when you're in Dentrix, for example, that you are listed as the provider and not the last hygienist that was seeing the patient. So we're documenting what we call the process of care, and that is really an integral component of each step of the dental hygiene process of care as we go through it. So every step in the process is going to be documented in each patient record and at every appointment. If it's not written down, it never happened. So comprehensive, accurate, concise documentation of each step really forms a complete and chronological record of each patient's oral health status, as well as the treatment that you've rendered over time. Luckily, we have templates for almost everything. Medical history, you pull up a template on the first visit and you fill out the template. Vital signs, you fill out the template. Everything that carries risk assessment, you fill out the template. So it guides you in what notes need to be done. Some offices are very loose and you're just writing down Med HX for medical history, patient states no changes. Vitals WNL within normal limits. It's varies from office to office, but you can't be too complete when it comes to dental records.
Misty, I'm sorry. Are you moving your slide or you just?
I'm not moving my slide yet.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
I'm still yakking. I'm sorry. I'm still yakking.
Okay.
But thank you for checking, because last week I forgot, didn't I? It was on the wrong screen. So you're the dental hygienist and you are going to be involved in a lot of moral and ethical and legal situations that really are related to documentation. You need to understand that the patient record can be subpoenaed in an event of litigation. Okay, and it's a basic tenet of ethical and legal risk management for professional practice. When I was in school, the mantra was, what would this chart entry look like if it was blown up on a screen and a jury had to see it? Was it legible? Because nobody had computers back then. Was it legible? That type of thing. Was it dated? Was it signed? So we need to really know and adhere to certain aspects, including HIPAA, which stands for Health Insurance Portability and Accountability Act. We're going to get into that in a little bit, for patient privacy. And this is a short chapter, but it is a critical chapter. So this is a table that goes over the essentials of ethical record keeping. And I like charts because it tends to have a lot of pages of information in one place. So if you understand what the concept is and what the explanation is on that concept and what the ethical application is for it, you pretty much have the chapter down. So think about possible test questions. This is dental hygiene, and Ms. D loves making questions that you have to apply the knowledge to. So you might get a question that is asking you a scenario, and then what is the ethical application, okay, for this scenario? So it's not just with dental hygiene, especially DNH 141, 142, 143, and all the other ones. It's not just memorizing information and spitting it back out. It's the application of information, unlike other courses like radiology. Okay, a lot of this is what we call black and white. You have to memorize it because A is A, B is in B, and A and B equals C, and that's what you memorize. Or if you increase A, then B is increased and other things happen. It's very logical, but when you have to apply your knowledge, there's always that gray area, and you have to pick the best answer. Oftentimes there's one right answer, but a lot of times one answer is better than the other. And that's where our discussions come in. So understand this table. We've got our learning objectives. Okay, let's talk a little bit about the patient record. They should all have the same characteristics. So patient records provide a means for communication between members of the healthcare team as well as their patients. So we need to have a complete patient record to facilitate coordinated planning as well as continuity of care. So patient records serve as a basis for the evaluation of the quality of care as well as aid when a review is made of the effectiveness of patient care practices. So again, if anything ends up in a court of law, the only thing they have to go on is the written record. That's it. So we need to be complete, and we need to be accurate, and we need to be able to interpret what the record stated if we are the same caregiver or if somebody else is looking at the record. So that's where coming in very concisely and knowing how to use the proper terminology and locations is so critical. So we use data from health records, okay, also for education and educating the patient. We document in the patient's record. It's considered a legal document, so everything has to be accurate. We also use it, not we, but it's used for forensics. If something happens, a mass disaster or a plane crash or a body is found, dental records are often what's used to help identify who that victim is. So it has to be accurate. It needs to be authentic. It needs to be comprehensive. It needs to be legible, and it needs to be objective as well. So patient record entries should be recorded immediately following treatment. That's best practice. Sometimes we have to wait until our lunch hour, and while we're eating our sandwich or whatever, we are entering in notes for the day. I've done that, and it is bad because I forget things. And then once you've written up the record, you can't alter it. But it needs to be recorded using clear, concise, and objective statements. It needs to be dated. It needs to be signed by the clinician, whether it's a computer, electronic record, or a hand record. You can put your initials or you sign your signature. If you are a temp and just there for a day, you sign your entire name. I would just put EJD next to my notes because I was a regular employee, for example, and 20 years from now, if something happened, EJD, oh, that was Elizabeth Jane DeSilvio. She was with me for 10 years, blah, blah, blah. So what are some of the components of a patient record? You need to, the format of the patient record is really going to vary depending from office to office and software to software, written, computerized, it doesn't matter. All information collected during the initial exam and during continuing patient appointments are an official part of the permanent record. So to meet the dental hygiene standard of care, all components of the dental hygiene process of care are addressed. That includes the components of a complete and regularly updated patient record, which is the medical dental history, vital signs, dental history, clinical assessment and diagnosis. Okay, that's your periodontal charting, your hard tissue charting, treatment recommendations, and written treatment plan. And this is where a lot of offices fail. They don't have a written treatment plan that the patient signs, that they have been explained to what's going on in their mouth, they've been explained to what is recommended, and they agree or disagree to it. Progress notes for each patient visit. And it needs to be signed. There has to be an acknowledgement of confidentiality measures. That's that HIPAA form we're going to be getting into a little bit later. And then there's additional components, such as the informed consent forms, which are part of the new patient that we have. We call it the super form in the computer. All of those consent forms, the radiographic consent form, that type of thing. We have the HIPAA, the radiographic consent form, local anesthesia consent form, treatment, consent for treatment, and authorization. If there is an exposure, okay, then both you and the patient agree that you'll be getting your blood tested within 48 hours. That's very critical. And the patient signs that. They used to have 6 places that they needed to sign, and then the instructor needed to sign, and then the student needed to sign. Well, now we call it the super form. So they read these forms and you review them with the patient, and then they just have to sign once. So we've got all sorts of things that are being recorded. And now with electronic records, it doesn't matter how many notes you keep. One of my offices back in 1981 had a little half page chart, and I was allowed 2 lines of that. He just wanted ReCare, prophy exam, 2 bite wings, and then recall 6 months. And that's all I was allowed to write. So being a new grad, I would write very small. Med HX for medical history, patient states no change, EOIO, intra-extraoral exam, NSF, no significant findings. You know, I would just, you know, perio, dot, dot. And he just, anyway, we didn't get along very well. But know that these are legal documents. If it's not written down or documented, it never happened. So we are going to be using electronic records, but some of this we're also going to make you do by hand, the old-fashioned way. You're going to learn how to do periodontal charting, both in the computer and on the written record. Same way with hard tissue charting, both in the computer and on the written record, because those are the 2 things that will probably you'll be faced with out in private practice. Everything else is very adaptable. And once you understand Dentrix, then if you're in an office that has Eagle Soft or Soft Dent, it's very easy to make that transition after a day or so. But the nice thing about the electronic record is things can be standardized. You won't write up your notes one way and the other hygienist won't write up the notes in another way. Hopefully there's a template that you both agree on that you can fill out, so things you can look for the same thing on every patient in the same area of the chart notes without having to read everything and try and hunt for it. So electronic records are wonderful, and they date and timestamp things for you. So even if you make a mistake and you have to go in and amend your notes, it will keep things in that chronological order. You can't cross something out or write in the margin. It'll date timestamp when you made that change, but it'll show as an addendum to whatever note you're trying to make. So for legalities, it's very nice. So let's talk just a little bit about this Health Insurance Portability and Accountability Act. This was came about in 1996. I graduated from dental hygiene school in 1981. And so this was something new where everybody had to start their HIPAA forms. And it was an effect for dental practices in the United States in April of 2003. So the HIPAA Act was enforced or became the HIPAA Act in 1996 for dental practices in 2003. So it's been around for 17 years now in dental offices. Patients are expected to sign that HIPAA form. Oh yeah, that's my privacy. It protects the patient records and other health-related information, and it is for the patient's privacy. So when this first came about, we were not allowed to, dental offices were not allowed to send off electronic records through the email unless it was encrypted. That way, in case it ended up on somebody else's desktop inadvertently, they wouldn't have health information on you or whatever the patient was. So the encryption is a software that scrambles everything up. So it goes from computer A to computer B in the form of letters and numbers and symbols. And then when it gets to computer B, they unscramble it. They have the same encryption software to unscramble it and make it into readable information. The problem was not everybody had encryption software and not everybody had the same encryption software. So computer A was sending it to computer B, but computer B, even though they had encryption software, it was a different kind, they couldn't unscramble it. So dental offices were then just illegally emailing stuff to computer A to computer B. And now the statement is, as long as you have an accurate statement in your HIPAA form and inform the patient that we will use unencrypted email to send these to the third party. However, every safety option will be utilized. Then and the patient signs it, that's all you need to do. So if you're working in a dental practice right now, just go to your HIPAA form and see. A lot of us haven't changed this since 2003, the language, because the patient only needs to sign it once. So if your HIPAA form states that you're sending things through encryption and you're not, you need to talk to your employer about possibly updating the HIPAA form and starting from scratch. All right, two separate components of addressing the privacy and security. So let's take a look a little bit about this HIPAA privacy rule. It establishes a national standard to protect individuals' privacy as well as access to medical records and other health information. So the HIPAA privacy rule gives patients the right to receive a copy of their personal health records. It's theirs. They've paid for it. They can ask to change incorrect or incomplete information. They have the right to say, this is not right. This is what I meant to say or whatever. And there are patients who do that. They can receive reports on when, why, and with whom their health information is shared. They can decide in some cases, such as marketing, whether the health information can be shared or not. And it asks, they can be asked to be contacted regarding health information in a specific location or by a specific method, like are you allowed to disclose anything through the mail or through the telephone. It also gives the patient the right to file a complaint with the provider, the health insurer, or the United States government regarding their concerns about the use of their health information. So healthcare facilities, and that's a dental office, is responsible for developing a privacy and confidentiality form that the patient signs. All offices have these. They need to adopt written policies and educate the staff, which is you, about confidentiality of patient information. And then there ideally is a staff privacy officer that's in charge of this to make sure that everything is updated and provides the patient with a notice of privacy practices document at the beginning of their care. So that's usually in the new patient packet that they get, as well as implement security measures and formal protocols to protect the patient information. And this officer can really be instrumental. It's almost like a mediator, okay? Instead of going directly to the doctor or to the office manager, it can go to the lead assistant or whoever's in charge of that. Somebody have a question? Okay. So health providers are responsible to comply with the protocols and practices as well. So in 2013, okay, that was 17 years ago, everything was updated to strengthen digital security standards. Now there are board questions on HIPAA, and we'll be discussing this also in your last semester here as well. You've got an ethics and jurisprudence course that goes into HIPAA in great detail. But this HIPAA security rule establishes a national set of security standards for protecting health information that is held or transferred in the electronic form. So there's three separate standards. You've got the administrative standards, and that's limited to the access of appropriate members of the workforce. There are physical safeguards, the use of storage systems and procedures that prevent access of unauthorized individuals. And then there's technical safeguards, and that's the use of technology like coding and encryption to control access to patient information. Now, just like with patient records, remember, if those of you that have worked in dental offices or medical practices, there's usually a hard drive that the receptionist or the doctor takes home with them. So in case there's a fire or a catastrophe happens or major theft, they still have an electronic record of everything that's going on. Unlike paper forms, once everything's burned down, it's burned down. So you want to document everything, right? And this is a lot of common sense, so you can just kind of catch your breath here. But specific objectives of the intra and extra oral examination are part of the total patient assessment. And that's going to be something that we're going to be working on next week, I believe. So it's the need for careful and thorough documentation of examination findings really can't be overemphasized. And that's why we need to be as specific as possible. And concentration and attention to detail are both necessary in order that slight deviations from what you're seeing from one time to the next can be entered in the record. So it's not just the patient has a cheek bite on the right cheek, okay? You are going to describe the lesion. It could be petechiae, it could be whatever. So let's say they've got a petechiae, small red dot, on the right buccal mucosa. Well, think about that right cheek. It's a big area. So then you have to also describe where it is. It's adjacent to the distobuccal cusp of tooth number two. So then you've got a landmark on what to go on. So the next time that patient comes in, it's either you or the doctor or somebody else is looking on the distobuccal of number two on the cheek surface to see if that lesion's still there or has it resolved. So we have to know the language that we're using, and we have to all use the same language. So this is just going over a little bit of the numbering systems. We're going to get into this later on in DNH 141. We're going to also get into this in oral anatomy. This is just a glimpse of the excitement to come, ladies and gentlemen. But you need to know what numbering system each office is using, because number 8 might mean the maxillary right canine in one numbering system, but it might mean a wisdom tooth in another numbering system. So you need to know what type of numbering system. And humans have 20 deciduous or baby teeth and 32 permanent teeth, okay, or the adult dentition. So for the universal numbering system, it's also called the continuous numbering system, okay? Universal or continuous, they changed the name last year to continuous, but most of the textbooks, you're still gonna be seeing universal. It's continuous because the teeth are numbered 1 through 32, and there's no repeating of numbers. So you start on the upper right, maxillary right, wisdom tooth with number 1, go all the way over to number 16, which is the maxillary left wisdom tooth, then you drop down to the bottom to number 17, it's the bottom left wisdom tooth, and go all the way around to the right, which is number 32. Now it's 1 through 32, but for the continuous numbering system for deciduous or primary or baby teeth, they use letters. So they use the letters A through T. You will see it in uppercase and you'll see it in lowercase. They're both fine. So A is the upper right, maxillary right, second molar, baby molar, goes all the way to the upper left second. Then it drops down to the lower left and goes all the way to the lower right again. So if you've got a picture of the teeth, you can count them A, B, C, D, E, F, G, that way to figure out which letter you're doing. So permanent teeth is the number, deciduous teeth are the letters. Now there's something called FDI, Federation Dentaire Internationale. It's a 2-digit way of identifying teeth, and it's called the international system. So for permanent teeth, the mouth is divided up into 4 quadrants, upper right, upper left, lower right, 1, 2, 3, and 4. And the tooth numbers within each quadrant are then numbered. So you start with number 1, which is the midline, the central incisors, goes all the way to number 8, which is the wisdom tooth. So you're going to have a 2-digit. You've got 2 digits are going to be pronounced separately. So you're going to have, for example, you're going to have the number 25. Now 25 could be tooth number 25 on the continuous system. Tooth number 25 is the mandibular central incisor, right central incisor. But if you say 25, that's showing us that you're using the FDI system, and it's and it means you're in the second quadrant, tooth number 2 from the midline. You can also see it as 2.5. So tooth number 25 is continuous, 2.5 is FDI, or 2.5 is FDI. Then there's the Palmer notation system, and that is has a little crosshatch to it, so it looks like a like tic-tac-toe almost, and depending on where the number is in that crosshatch will tell you what quadrant it is and what number of tooth it is, and that's the Palmer notation system. So review that in the textbook. It is fairly straightforward. You just need to know how many teeth are in each quadrant. So we're using charting, and we're going to be going over hard tissue charting later on this semester as well, and what the symbols are. But for our purposes, as long as we can tell what you mean, it's going to be good enough. Some offices will have you X out missing teeth on paper. Some will have you shade them out. They're both the same thing. It depends on office preference. But that includes a diagrammic representation of existing conditions of the teeth. So if you're the hygienist that's seeing the patient the first time, oftentimes you're in charge of crossing out missing teeth, charting what the patient comes in at. You're charting existing restorations, you're doing a full periodontal workup, and you're getting the chart ready. In other offices, the dentist sees the patient first and does what we call a comprehensive exam. So they've done all of that. They've done the periodontal charting and the treatment plan for the patient, and that's already been set up. So you're seeing the patient for the first time to do your scaling and root debridement. You've never met them before. And that's okay, but the only problem with that is if you differ with what the treatment plan was. And that does happen. So you've got to be neat about this. We used to have red and blue pencils. Now they've got erasable pens, which are so nice because they're a lot neater. Pencils are very hard to keep sharp. But charting can also include using the radiographs for charting composites and other things that are going on, and study models as well. I was in one practice who took study models on every new patient. This is what your mouth looked like today. So 20 years from now, I still know what your mouth looked like today. I don't have to guess at it. And now with intraoral cameras, we can take pictures of things. Periodontal records, we're going to be going into at great length. Color, contour, consistency of the gingiva. If things are red, is it the same red? Or is it a purplish red, or a magenta, or a salmon pink, or a coral pink? We've got all these terms that we could use, right? And items to be charted, we're gonna be going at where is the gingiva on the tooth, as well as how much attached gum tissue do they have around it? You don't need to know what that is yet. And deposits, calculus, tartar stain, where and how much is it? So we're going to be talking about the language and how to chart that. Factors related to occlusion, we're going to be getting into more oral anatomy as well. And we are making a preliminary dental hygiene diagnosis on our patient. Now, dental hygienists are not allowed to diagnose, but we have something called a dental hygiene diagnosis. So we're not saying that you have, for example, an aphthous ulcer on the lower lip. That's a canker sore. It looks like a canker sore. We know it's a canker sore, but we are describing the lesion on the lower lip adjacent to tooth number 26, which would be the lower left lateral incisor. Patient states injured while eating, okay, they bit their lip or something like that, then your clinical impression is that it's an aphthous ulcer. You're not saying it's an aphthi, but it's your clinical impression, aphthous. We all have now a picture in our head. Oh, okay, I know that. Everybody knows what a canker sore looks like after you've seen one or something else, okay? So that's our clinical impression as evidenced by, okay, as evidenced by this type of lesion, and the patient stated that they bit their lip. Dental hygiene diagnosis. Okay, dental records are coming in different forms, an anatomic tooth chart or a geographic or geometry type of tooth chart. They're all different, but the mesial is always going to be the mesial and the distal is always going to be the distal. I like the old paper charts where it was an anatomic tooth chart and it had lines for the gingiva. We would draw in where the gingiva is. We would draw in where the mucogingival line is on the patient. And if we'd also draw in their restorations as we saw it. So unlike a computer form that just puts in a filling or a crown or whatever it is that you're telling the computer, you can customize it. Oh, it's higher on the mesial and slopes down to the distal. You can really be drawing it like you see it. Can't do that with the computer, but you can do that with intraoral photos. So our care plan records, okay, also has the dental hygiene care plan, and that includes the dental hygiene diagnostic statements. Right, we're going to be getting into that. You don't need to know that right now, but also it addresses the patient's risk factors. You are going to be doing a caries risk assessment when you see your new patient. Medical history, oral inspection, caries risk assessment. That will guide you on, do you need to take radiographs for this patient or not? How frequently do you need to take radiographs? How often are they snacking? Have they ever had periodontal surgery before? You're asking these kind of questions. Are they drinking fluoridated water? What is their risk of developing decay? If they are at high risk, you need to take radiographs more frequently than if they're at a low risk. So you're including all of that, as well as informed consent from the patient. Now, this is the treatment plan informed consent, all right? By just virtue of them being there, they are giving implied consent, but you need to have an informed consent for everything you do. They're in the chair, they're in there for a filling, something happens, and then they need a crown, or they need a root canal. It's no longer a filling. The dentist has to stop and has to explain this to the patient. Okay, this happened, the tooth broke off or whatever. This is what I need to do now. And this is how much it's going to cost. That's part of the treatment plan. How much is it going to cost? Because when they go up to the front, they're not going to be happy if they say, Dr. Jones never told me, and Dr. Jones is going to look at you saying, why didn't you tell him? So we are documenting everything. If it's not written down, it didn't happen. The systematic approach, often some offices will use the SOAP approach, S-O-A-P, and that stands for subjective, objective, assessment, and procedures. Know what the SOAP approach is. There are board questions on SOAP approach and what part of the SOAP is this. SOAP, hospitals have been using it for years and years, but it's a systematic standardized approach to writing a patient's notes. So some computers will have the S, the O, the A, and the P, and then you fill in those blanks. I've only been in one office that's done SOAP notes. I learned SOAP notes when I started out in nursing school. And that's where I first heard of SOAP notes. Essential components of a patient progress note. Okay, you, by filling out the Dentrix forms, will automatically have all of this in. So it's important that we discuss things with our patient as well, as far as why we're doing things, because they're looking at you as you're entering all these things into the computer, type, 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 and they're going, oh God, when are you going to start cleaning my teeth? So it's important that the patient knows what we're doing and why. Are there any questions on documentation? Okay. What we're going to do is take a short break. Let's come back. Let's see. It is, it's 1:05. Let's come back at 1:10 and we'll pick up where we left off. So I'm going to put us on pause. Thank you. We're going to continue our discussion. We talked about documentation and the importance of it. Now let's talk about medical, dental, and psychosocial histories. Psychosocial, they changed the name of this chapter. It used to just be personal, dental, and medical histories, but now it's psychosocial. But this is all part of the assessment aspect of what we're doing. So this is what we call ADPID. And the way we configure our education is by following this ADPID. This is on your boards. It's going to be on every test you take as far as what do things stand for. ADD, A-D-P-I-E-D. So we are going to be starting with assessments, and assessments gathering and analyzing health information as well as clinical data. Then it goes on to diagnose, which is the problem identification. Okay. After you have all of your assessment, we can then see what the situation is for that particular patient. Then we can make a plan of action. That's your treatment plan or your selection of interventions. What treatment do they need? Then we implement things, which is activating the plan. We evaluate, did it work or did it not work? And after each of those, we document, document, document. Because again, if it wasn't documented, it never happened. So ADPID. All right, we're starting with the assessment, right? So part of this is really the first step of the dental hygiene process of care, assessment, right? It's a critical analysis of the data, and it helps identify the patient problems used to formulate what we call the dental hygiene diagnosis, as well as develop an individual care plan for the patient. It's comprehensive and accurate, and it really helps the hygienist in identifying health-related factors that can affect the management of the dental hygiene care, risk factors for oral or systemic disease, a description of the personal and culturally related habits that affect oral status, as well as health-related attributes of the patient and the value placed on the maintenance of oral health, as well as the prevention of disease, because everybody's continuum is a little bit different. Where do they value their oral health? So it also incorporates oral hygiene methods and communication strategies, but it's built into the sequence of clinical procedures, and assessment is the initiation of the steps for arresting oral disease, as well as controlling the etiological factors, biofilm, bacteria, that type of thing. So what's the ethical application of all of this? Well, an ethical theory is often based on norms or rules that ask which type of action would be morally correct, and it offers a general approach to an ethical problem. So a dental professional such as you may need to consider the most favorable outcome of a particular situation and what guidelines to follow, whether to rely on personal or professional virtues when making a particular judgment. We're going to be talking about that. You've got a whole semester of that. But a few of the many philosophical theories that apply to the delivery of dental care, along with their corresponding descriptions, are going to be discussed here. And this is everything in a nice chart form. I like charts because this is all you need to know. So look at the different theories, the definitions, and the application aspects of it. I'm not going to get into each of these, but you have to have an understanding of them. This will probably come back to haunt you when you're studying for your boards. All right, so we've got our learning objectives for the chapter, and let's dive in. So for safe, evidence-based dental and dental hygiene care. Now, evidence-based should not be a new term for you with the reading that you've done. A thorough patient health history is really an essential part of the complete assessment. We don't do anything without a signed health history. If something's disappeared in the computer, we got to start all over again if we don't have a signed health history. So if you look on box 10-1, I don't have it here. Okay. 10-1 has a lot of information in it. So take a look at that. But the history directs and guides the steps that need to be taken in preparation for, during, and following appointments. So some of the things that a health history will do is give the history that's needed before an oral examination procedure. Are you allowed to put anything in their mouth without causing any harm? Such as a probe or an explorer, okay, which may cause bleeding. You want to know what instruments that would need to be used to manipulate soft tissue around the teeth. Okay, is anything contraindicated until it's been determined? Does that patient need to have some sort of a prophylactic antibiotic or other something going on along with blood thinners and other things that are happening with the patient? And when a question exists about the medical history that the patient's describing, do you need to have a consultation? Do you need to contact the primary care provider or not? So even emergency treatment might need to be postponed if there are things showing up on the medical history. So this is a legal document. It needs to be reviewed and signed by the patient each and every appointment. So when you are in dental hygiene school, you will have a morning appointment, you'll have a lunch break, and you'll have an afternoon appointment. If you have the same patient coming in the morning and in the afternoon, you are not starting that afternoon session until you do a medical history, new vitals, and then a new oral inspection. What changed, if anything, over the lunch hour? Did you take any medications? It's not that you're spending an hour reviewing the medical history with them again, you're just reviewing it. Have there been any changes since this morning? Have you taken any medication during the lunch hour? Okay, a lot of times they'll take an Advil or a sinus pill or something. Okay, did they eat? What's their blood sugar like?
Excuse me, Mrs. D?
Yeah.
Can I ask a quick question?
Absolutely.
Thank you. You had said to look at table 10 or figure 10-1. Did you mean 11-1?
11-1. I lied.
Okay, yeah. Good. I was looking everywhere for 10-1 thinking it related. 11-1 totally fits. All right. Thank you so much.
I'm sorry.
That's okay. It's all right.
The medical history for the patient is not just to be taken once. No longer are we asking the patient, are there any changes in your medical history since you were in last time? No longer are we asking patients, did you take your pre-medication today? I did. I used to do that back in the 80s. Did you take your pre-med today? Yes, great. And I wrote down, patient took pre-med. Little did I know my lack of understanding of thorough documentation. Okay, so now it's patient states, all right, because the patient is telling me, if I say patient took the pre-med, that means I can testify in a court of law that I know by fact that the patient took their pre-med. And did they take all of it? Found out the hard way. Well, I only had two left instead of the four I was supposed to take. So I took two. Okay. So now it's patient states. They took four, you know, blah, 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 200 milligrams of clindamycin or whatever it is, 1 hour ago. Patient states that they did that. That is much more accurate. Right. And we're going to help you with this wording as you are doing it. But we want to know also with their medical history, it's not a static thing. It's very fluid from one appointment to the next. So it's constantly changing and needs to be updated every single visit. Our school rules are a medical history needs to be rewritten, updated every 3 years. So when you're getting your WeCare patients coming in, you need to find out when the last medical history was filled out. And if it's been 3 years or more, they need to fill out a new one, which is time consuming. So be prepared for that. Know that before the patient comes in. Or anytime there's been a lot of changes in the medical history, we ask that the patient fill out a new one if it's been a major change. Otherwise, we can just use the same medical history because once that's saved in the computer, you're not going back and making any notes on that medical history. So we have to know that if there's an incident occurring in the clinic, say a patient faints and does not recover, and EMTs have to be called, 911 has to be called. They want to know exactly what medications are they on now, what were their vital signs today, not 6 months ago, what were they today? What medications did they take today? And that type of thing. And one of the courses that I take from a pharmacologist, he teaches pharmacology in a number of dental hygiene schools, and he's just so cute, I love him, says he doesn't ask what medications are you taking. He asks what are you taking, including over the counter, because they don't look, patients don't look at herbal medications or herbal treatments as a medication. And some of these herbals can interact with prescription medication or other over the counter medication. They can thin the blood. They can have some real consequences to dental hygiene treatment. So you want to know everything that the patient's putting in their mouth. And yes, you're going to be making drug cards for everything. All right, so patient preparation. There are a number of different types of things that your offices are going to be doing. One of them is sending all this information out before the appointment, and then they send them back into a portal or send them back in through the mail, but most of it's computerized now. So the office has all the consent forms, the medical history and everything before the patient even shows up. But it could be something as simple as when you're making an appointment for a patient in the clinic, you're doing sort of a pre-appointment questionnaire. Don't need to ask their age. Are you taking any medication? Could you give me a list of your medication and the dosages? If you don't have it, I need a list of the medications and your dosages. Have you been hospitalized within the last 6 months? Do you have any heart ailments that you know of? These are the pre-appointments. Is this patient going to require possibly pre-medication or a medical consult before they come in? Now in school, we're going to be having a lot of patients needing medical consults, more so than private practice. If the patient can walk in on their own volition, the doctor wants you to see them. Here, at school, we want a medical consult. So if your patient is pregnant, we need a medical consult for that. Do you get one in private practice? Heavens no, unless there's complications going on. So we're doing pre-appointment, a telephone interview or whatever. Then there's also the self-history, and that can be prepared at home. So that's something that the patient can provide you. They're either downloading something and then doing it before they send it in. That is a self-history. And then there's the complete history. And that is made at the time of the initial visit. And that's a combination of the questionnaire that the patient fills out and the interview. And that's really what we're doing a lot of times. The patient can fill out the medical history. You can send them the e-form, the PDF, before they come in. It's not in the computer, so you have to transfer everything. But as you're transferring things, you're asking them and just clarifying questions. So that's a combination, and the best way to do it is the interview along with the questionnaire. And then at subsequent appointments, the complete history is just reviewed for changes since the last time. We're always asking, give me a list of your medications, dosages, and why you're taking the medication, because there's so many reasons why patients are taking medications that are off label. We want to know that if this blood pressure medication is being taken for something for blood pressure, that's fine. We put in parentheses BP, but if it's taken for another reason, say for migraine headaches or something else, we want to know what why they're taking that. And then all the other supplemental forms that go with it. That's what we call the new patient packet. So there are some limitations to the history as well, because this is self-reporting. We have to believe what the patient's telling us. Okay, so a medical history is considered subjective. We're going to get into that again in perio. We're going to be reviewing all of this in DNH 146 this time next year, but it is subjective. I am 5'11 and weigh 120 pounds, and I'm a natural blonde. And you're going to look at me and go, okay, Ms. D, sure you are, but that's what I'm reporting that I am. Am I? Of course not. So there are some limitations to that. And the patients are always going to ask, why do you need to know this? I'm only here for a cleaning. So it's important that the patients understand that we are here to treat their whole body. Yes, you're here for a cleaning, but there's so much evidence now about the oral systemic link, and even commercials on TV and ads in magazines and everything is integrating that oral systemic link, that what happens in the mouth can affect other regions of the body. So that's why we need to ask, okay? And it helps build rapport, and we're chatting with the patient. Oh, I'm not familiar with that condition or that medication or whatever. Can you tell me a little bit about it? And they love talking about themselves and educating you and that type of thing. So you might hear us saying, oh, I'm not familiar with that. I do this all the time. I'm seriously, I do. Could you tell me about this? I might know about it, but I might not. You know, why are you taking this? Did it work for you? Okay, it's something else. And that's how you learn about all the medications that are out there as well, because there are so many. You can't memorize them all, which is why you have to have your drug cards. Okay, now in private practice, do you have your drug cards? Heavens no. But you're treating the whole person. We want you to have these drug cards out for each and every patient. Next semester, when you start seeing patients, you will be able to buy the box of cards. Okay, but you also need to make sure that the dental implications are written down. All right, that's how you get to learn these medications. Birth control pills, for example, there are dozens of different brands out there, but if you know the generic characteristics of a low dose birth control pill, oral contraceptive, that's all you need to know. And then what are the oral implications? So it starts the conversation. But there are, as I said, some limitations to these. So a questionnaire doesn't satisfy everything. All right. So we always, always need to follow things up with the interview process. So the combination of two is really the best. So there can be system-oriented, disease-oriented, symptom-oriented, or culture-oriented questions, all right? And most questionnaires are system oriented. They'll go over the breathing or the asthma questions. Then they'll have a section of questions that have to do with diabetes. Do you bruise easily? Do you urinate frequently? Are you thirsty much of the time? All right, those are the diabetes questions. Are you, then the heart related questions. Okay, those are the system oriented, and they'll combine it with the symptom oriented as well. Can you walk up a flight of stairs without getting winded? I have to say no to that one. And that lets you know also what their activities of daily living and everything else is all about. So a good questionnaire touches on all of these, and especially in an area where we are, like Northern Virginia, we are really blessed to have a very diverse population here. And people are coming from all over the world. We get to learn so much from them and what their values are and their diets and their medicines and everything else, that it makes it interesting. It really makes it interesting. And we get to, they get to educate us as we get to educate them. So we need to, for this cultural diversity that we're in, we need to really be sensitive to the patient's background. It helps us identify ethnic or gender-related diseases that the patient might be at risk for. It helps us determine traditionally culturally related health beliefs that really may influence our dental hygiene interventions. So where are they on that continuum of how important is dental hygiene to them, right? A lot of patients we're seeing are coming into the dentist for the very first time. They've never had a dental cleaning because where they're from, that wasn't part of their hierarchy of needs. We also, with cultural orientation, we need to have a respect, if we can, of what their personal space is. We might think they're avoiding eye contact with us, but they might think I am staring at them for different reasons. I think I'm being polite by trying to look them in the eye, but where they're coming from, they might look at that as a sign of disrespect. All right, we're going into their bubble, that personal space. Okay, some cultures and some people need a wide personal space. And what are we doing? We're just bellying up right there with them, and we're touching them and going inside their mouth and really violating their personal space. And there can be gender biases as well, where if you're a man or a woman that's being the clinician, the patient might look at you in a different way because of your gender. So we have to respect that. And sometimes we don't find out until we've done something inappropriate without meaning to. And they complain. I had one patient I thought I had a great rapport with, and he was younger than me. This was a number of years ago, and we were chatting, and I had my record, my chart in my hand, and I said, oh, come on, whatever his first name was, okay? And I kind of tapped him on the shoulder. I said, you know better than that. And I was just teasing. He refused to see me again after that because I showed him disrespect by hitting him. I tapped him on the shoulder, and my employer said, what the hell were you thinking? It's like, I'm sorry, I was just joking around. So everybody will take you differently. And I'm still learning that at my ripe old age. I'm still learning that. I think I'm hilarious, people. Not everybody does. So the questionnaire is great, but we have to follow up with the interview. Okay. Any yes response. We need to have some sort of something written down that shows that we've asked the question. Our goal as the instructors are, when we come to a completed medical history, that we don't have to ask any questions because you have followed up with all the questions. But right now, you don't know what questions to follow up with. So we're teaching you, okay, what questions would you ask? Right. And just by virtue of knowing that you need more information is a good start. Okay. But having everything filled out ahead of time can be very time saving if you follow things up. Okay. So what are some of the disadvantages of a questionnaire? Okay. If you don't follow it up with the interview, it's very impersonal and inflexible. And I've been with some clinicians in the medical field that never even bothered to look at my medical history, because there's usually what are you here for today? Or do you have any concerns? That type of stuff. And they just walk into the room and start. And it's like, okay, you never even bothered to look, did ya? So the interview is really meant to be, we are going through the interview, all right? One question at a time and filling it in. Now, there are some patients that we're doing this for, all right? Especially if they don't have a computer and they didn't do things ahead of time. Okay. We've got to ask them and they're telling us, asking us and telling us, that type of stuff. So we want to make sure that the patient has some privacy, which is hard to do in a clinic setting and in an open base setting. So that means we have to modulate our voice. And for Ms. D, modulation of voice, talking in a quiet voice, is very hard to do. I don't do it well. I am a loud, boisterous, big personality. And so you need to be respectful of the patient, especially if they're talking about personal things. It's a HIPAA violation for one thing. Oh, you had a sexually transmitted disease? Which one did you have? When did you have it? Were you treated for it? Okay, nobody needs to know that. So we need to be able to modulate our voice and ask questions in a safe manner to make the patient comfortable. So we need to be tactful and friendly and understanding. And we need to reassure the patient, and we need to be non-judgmental. And that is the big thing. We need to be non-judgmental. You are going to have patients that are in the chair that are so embarrassed about their previous life, let's say drug use or dental care or whatever. They're so embarrassed. And you just need to let that patient know that I'm glad you're here today. Okay, I'm glad you're here today. This is going to be the start of you taking care of yourself. And that just puts them at ease. Am I making myself sense here? So we've got to really customize how we approach our patients. So we can develop rapport, we can also cater our questions to individual needs. The disadvantage is, one of them is, it takes time because we have to ask each and every question that's on the medical history, versus if they've already had it and turned it in, you can say, oh, I see that you're healthy. You're not taking any medications. And then you're just going, you don't have any heart medications. You're not allergic to any medications. You're just asking the big questions if they've got a completely negative medical history. So it goes much faster, right? So information directly related to how goals are established and will be accomplished need to be addressed. Okay, you're getting information about the patient, especially their cultural, their financial, their social. Where is dentistry on their list of importance? Are they in any pain? That is their primary concern. Let's get you out of pain first, then we'll talk about whitening your teeth. Because patients, it's amazing, that will come in with a horrible mouth, but they want their teeth whitened. And you'll address that. But first, we've got these other things that we need to address. So there is a dental history, a medical history part, and a psychosocial history part. Do you smoke? Do you drink? How often do you drink? Do you, well, only when I'm smoking. Well, how often do you smoke? Only when I'm in a bar. Well, how often do you go to a bar? I mean, you're just trying to get a feel for what the patient's doing. I smoke a pack of cigarettes every day. You haven't even looked in the patient's mouth or taken their blood pressure or anything yet, but you are already formulating what to expect, okay, or what to be looking for. Do you need a medical consultation? And this is where your program policy manual is important, that orange manual or whatever color it is. That will tell you who needs a medical consultation and who doesn't. Does the patient have high blood pressure? Can you treat them? Do they need to be referred out? There's a page for that that lets you know. Yes, you can still treat them, but they need a medical consult. No, they need to be dismissed today. All right, so we've tried to make a policy manual that will answer those questions. And what I do with mine is I just put little tabs in it. I've got blood pressure. I got a tab for it, because that's the one that comes up most often. Blood pressure. I can go right to it to see what our guidelines are, because I don't remember that verbatim. Radiation, is the patient undergoing radiation? Can they have radiographs taken? What is that ELERA, their maximum permissible dose, the MPD? Have you gotten into that yet in radiology?
Not yet.
You'll get into that. MPD, maximum permissible dose. Somebody came up with an amount that we're allowed to have each year. We work in radiation every day. So they said we can have 5 or 50 rem. But if we don't work in radiation every day, we can have 0.1 every year. Now that just doesn't make sense to me. You're saying I can have 5 a year and they can have 0.1. Shouldn't I be the 0.1 because I'm going to be exposed every year? Doesn't make sense. Can you safely take radiographs on this patient? What else have they had going on? Okay. And then there's that prophylactic premedication, and those darn guidelines change all the time. They're never consistent. So the American Heart Association's made recommendations for the prevention of infective endocarditis a long time ago. And the first document came out in 1955, which was a great year because that's the year I was born. It's not going to be a test question, but 1955, long time ago. And there's been 9 revisions ever since. Okay, and we oftentimes frequent the American Heart Association website, right? But the latest one, okay, was they did a change in 2007 and then in 2014. And what they're doing is they're getting more and more conservative with who needs to be pre-medicated. It used to be if you hiccuped, you needed to take pre-medication. Right. Well, now they're finding that the prevalence of resistance to the antibiotic or the possibility of developing an allergic reaction to the antibiotic are so much more. The risk of that is more than the infective endocarditis. So they're becoming more and more conservative. So 2014 is the latest one. Again, you have the guidelines from that in your policy manual. So you want to take a look at that, but antibiotic prophylaxis may prevent a very small number of cases that infective endocarditis receiving dental care, because if we put something in the patient's mouth and there's any bleeding, the bacteria that's in the mouth is now traveling through their bloodstream. So if they have a heart valve that's damaged, that bacteria likes to settle around that defective heart valve, causing endocarditis. It doesn't happen right away. It can happen 2 weeks later. And by that time, they've forgotten that they went to the dentist. So we need to know what patients are at risk and what the recommendations are. And we always defer to their cardiologist or their primary care physician. We do educate the patient. Well, my cardiologist wants me to be on pre-medication for my hip implant for the rest of my life. Okay, that's fine. There might be other things going on, but the American Heart Association is saying after 6 months or after a year, you don't need to be pre-medicated because the bacteria that infects an implant like a hip implant or hip replacement is not the bacteria that's from the mouth. So they stopped, the osteopaths and everybody stopped recommending routine antibiotic prophylaxis for a number of these things that we used to have the patient prescribed antibiotics for life before any dental treatment. And it used to be they'd start 2 days before and be on it for 2 days after. Now it's just taking two pills an hour before and that's it. Okay. Or depending on the routine, two pills an hour before and one pill 6 hours later. Again, depending on the medication that they're on. So we want to weigh the risks and the benefits, right? Infective endocarditis for dental procedures is, can happen. So prophylaxis antibiotics is recommended for certain cardiac conditions. We might be needing to call their physician in private practice. It's a phone call with us. It's filling out a form and sending it off. So the boxes in 11, 11.2 and 11.3 can go over some of this, these processes for you. But there's recommendation for antibiotics is based on four principles. First one is only an extremely small number of cases of infective endocarditis are really prevented with the antibiotics. So there's no such thing as because you're taking the antibiotic, you're 100% covered. Infective and endocarditis prophylaxis, the antibiotics for dental procedures is recommended only for patients with underlying cardiac conditions associated with the highest risk of adverse outcomes. So it's risk versus benefits. Now, what are some of the other medical conditions that might require pre-medication? All right, again, look at those boxes, 11.2 and 11.3 for some of that. Also, look in your procedure manual because ours may differ a little bit from what the American Academy of Orthopedic Surgeons, AAOS, have. But in 2012, a review found no direct evidence that dental procedures causes any type of orthopedic implant infections. So again, we're very conservative with that. It's not necessary anymore. But there are times when a patient will need to be pre-medicated, and if they need to be pre-medicated, you are limited into what you can do until they are pre-medicated or we know. And that includes manipulation of the gingival tissues, right? If anything's going to be causing bleeding, we don't do it. The periapical region of the teeth, do they have root canal issues going on or abscesses? Or is there a chance of perforation of the oral mucosa that might need antibiotic premedication? So if we had a patient coming in for an injection and an occlusal filling, if they needed an injection, they used to be premedicated for it. Now, if it's just the one injection or two injections, they don't need to be premedicated. So some of this is routine. Now, and we are taking a breath, but if a patient comes in and says their doctor wants them to be premedicated, we premedicate them. Well, my doctor said, but then I forgot. Well, your doctor said, guess what? You're going home. So it's not recommended now, and it used to be, is local anesthetic injections, taking radiographs. What happens if I cut the floor of the mouth a little bit? It's going to be okay. Placement and removable of prosthodontic or orthodontic appliances. There might be a little bit of bleeding involved, but that's okay. Adjustment of orthodontic appliances, placement of orthodontic brackets, the shedding of primary teeth. That's losing your baby teeth. Okay, that's a natural thing. Or bleeding from trauma to the lips or oral mucosa. They bite themselves. They don't need to be premedicated for that. I was had one patient who said, this was years ago, their heart doctor told them not to floss because flossing can create bleeding and bleeding can create the endocarditis. And I'm scratching my head going, boy, that's a recipe for disaster. Now, we talked just a little bit about this with medical history. Your ASA levels are in your book. So again, use your book. ASA 1, are they healthy? Not on any medication. Okay, no systemic diseases. ASA 2, mild systemic disease, or everything's controlled with medication. ASA 3, patient that has severe systemic diseases that limits activity but it's not incapacitating. It could be also comorbidity. In ASA 2, if they've got four different things that are being managed with medication, you might consider them an ASA 3. ASA 4, a patient with incapacitating systemic diseases that is in constant threat of life. We usually don't see ASA 4s or ASA 5s. That's the one that's not expecting to survive for 24 hours. And you could be an ASA 1 in the morning and be an ASA 2 in the afternoon because you took out sinus medication or you took ibuprofen or something. So the ASA is very fluid as well, and it's not black and white. Oral contraceptives is one of those things. If a woman is on oral contraceptives, are they an ASA 1 or an ASA 2? Some might say 2. We are saying ASA 2 because they're taking something on a daily basis. And it might be to control their menstrual cycle. It might be to prevent pregnancy. But we don't care. They're on this medication that is mimicking pregnancy in the mouth. That pregnancy in the mouth could mimic gingivitis, pregnancy gingivitis, as well as bleeding, as well as blood clots. So we make them an ASA 2. So you want to follow what your office is doing. So we have discussions about this. Okay. It's not, you know, you're wrong and I'm right, or I'm right and you're wrong. You know, notice how I said that. Because it's fluid. So one instructor might say something and another instructor might say something else. We're both correct because it's that gray area. So don't get frustrated with us, right? So we are reviewing and updating this medical history at each and every appointment. We're recording changes. We are also having the patient sign it, okay, that there are no changes or that the patient states that this is as accurate as they can be. So if they lied and they misrepresented themselves and we asked the appropriate questions and something happens, they signed that they were telling us the truth. Recreational drugs. When did you take them last? Okay, what did you take and when? Can we give local anesthesia? Right? If they're on cocaine or have taken cocaine in the last 24 hours, we can't give them local anesthesia. But they could come in and say and lie. And say, oh no, you know, blah, 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 and something could happen. Well, the patient stated they weren't on any medication for the last 24 hours. We are in the right, they are in the wrong. It doesn't make them living, but it makes it legal. So it's important that the patient understand everything that we're doing. If we're using paper forms, everything has to be signed in ink. Everything needs to be dated. Store electronic patient records on secure server or password protected computer. That's usually something, again, that the receptionist, office manager, doctor will take a backup home. Record patient signatures. We have a signature pad that's not working right now in the clinic, but that's okay. We'll work around that. And we want to maintain the strictest privacy. So we can't be talking to Mrs. Smith about Mr. Smith's medical history or vice versa, or Aunt Susie, if you're seeing the whole family. We have to keep their personal stuff personal. Okay. Coded systems for pre-medication alert. We used to have red stickers that went on the outside of the chart that said medical alert, medical alert. And then we'd have other stickers. We'd put BP, allergic to amoxicillin, all sorts of other stuff. And then back in the 80s, especially with HIV, it became a patient privacy issue instead of just a convenience issue. Wouldn't it be nice to know if you had a red sticker on your chart that that said pre-medication, that you needed to be pre-medicated, but that's a violation of that privacy. So now we just have symbols or something. So in the last office I was in before they went paperless, I would tell the patient, I'm putting a red sticker on your chart. This red sticker lets us know you have insurance. I'm telling them what that means. Okay. Just means you have insurance. Has nothing to do with their personal stuff. We had other things inside the chart to denote. Okay. Danger, Will Robinson, danger. But we also have to evaluate these forms periodically. So it's important that the patient have a trusting relationship with us and know why we're asking these certain questions. Okay.